Hello, everyone, and thank you for coming to our panel, Images in a New Headline. We're going to be exploring use of images in social media, and we've got a fantastic panel here for you today with four different speakers who all have their own point of view on use of images. Before we get started, just wanted to say it's pretty obvious that images are more important in marketing than they've ever been. If we look at what's happening with Pinterest, Instagram, Tumblr, Facebook timeline, and the fact that there's literally 300 million photos uploaded every single day on Facebook, we can see the trends are pretty obvious. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna have each panelist give a quick presentation on their point of view, and then we're gonna have a roundtable discussion, and then we're gonna take questions from the audience at the end. So to my left here is Ken Leverenz from Getty Images. Next is Yoli Chisholm from Microsoft, Marissa Brooks from glassybaby, and Shauna Causey from Decide.com. So we're gonna start with you, Ken.
Thanks, Karen. Yes, I am Ken Leverenz. I am Director of Sales for Getty Images. For those of you looking at the print program, I am not Pamela, the name is Ken. So the storm in New York, unfortunately, delayed her being able to get out here, so I was lucky enough to fill in. So naturally, if we're talking about imagery, Getty Images hopefully would have a point of view on that. And you know, at Getty Images, we spend a great deal of time and resources researching visual trends for a number of reasons. Obviously, we want to be supplying our customers with relevant content currently, but you know, we also need to look at what are visual communicators going to be doing 6 months, 12 months from now. So for my piece of this, you know, I think nothing has really changed the visual landscape of communications more than social media has over the past 5 years. So I'm just going to quickly walk through a report that we put out recently, and you can go to curve.gettyimages.com. It's a report that we typically put out quarterly on a different vertical, just examining the visual landscape for a particular industry. And our most recent one that we put out was around technology, and more specifically around how social media has really changed the way that visual communications look. So I'm just going to run through quick four different trends that we've identified as a result of social media. You know, the first being what we call instant nostalgia. And what this is really with smartphones and, again, Instagram, Facebook, people are documenting their lives as they live them in real time. And, you know, I think it's really interesting how all of us have become not only voyeurs of looking at everyone we're connected to and how they live their lives, but exhibitionists at the same time, you know, constantly posting photos and images of what we're doing in real time. And I think it was pretty interesting. You'll notice from some of our coverage of the Olympics, you know, all of the athletes, when they were coming in, nearly all of them who were there to be looked at were also carrying phones, cameras, video cameras to document their own experiences, you know, in real time. And I think it's just such an interesting trend that has been emerging. And you'll notice overall the style of advertising and marketing across a number of different brands has really changed as a result of social media, because we're so inundated with real images of our friends doing things in a very documentary way, that there has really been sort of this sharp trend and change in the way that and the style of imagery that advertisers are using. It's a much more, again, you know, smartphone-y, snapshot-y look and feel across brands that, you know, 5 years ago wasn't the case. You know, it was all very polished, professional, and you've got these solar flares, and you know, it's to us, we treat this as much more authentic. You know, it's not just against still imagery. You know, these are a number of different McDonald's spots that are video spots, but again, take on that same sort of, you know, smartphone-esque Instagram style. And again, you know, it's across all different types of brands that you notice this style of imagery popping up. The second trend is what we call anti-vanity. And you know, as people are posting things through Instagram and Facebook, we seem to have become experts at branding ourselves and the way that we want to come across through our social media channels. You know, and it's sort of this, you know, perfect imperfection that I think you'll notice that many of your friends will try to achieve through a lot of their Facebook feeds, where it's not, you're not always looking that glamorous, you're looking silly, you're looking quirky, but to us that's real life. You know, and this is actually one of Pam's friends, but just showing some of the photos of her friend, and you know, it's okay to not be all done up and look your best. You know, it just helps you communicate your experiences in real time. And I think it's because of this feed of imagery that we are constantly seeing from our friends and even celebrities that has really changed the way that brands are advertising. You know, with Twitter and the like, you know, you see a lot more celebrities, you know, putting out photos of themselves not looking their best. You know, Tyra Banks without makeup, you know, God forbid, but you know, she's a real person. Yeah. Terry Hatcher showing that she can actually create wrinkles on her eyebrow or on her forehead. You know, again, just looking very natural, and I think this lends itself to visual communications. And what we've seen is a big backlash towards Photoshop. You know, a number of organizations and sites have popped up to show how Photoshop is creating a false sense of reality for celebrities, and a big pushback on ad campaigns to be much more natural in the way that they look. You know, here was an ad for L'Oreal of the first unretouched makeup ad, you know, and I think that this is a trend that social media has really spurned. The third trend that we look towards is this pushback for real models and real people. You know, the most common feedback that we get at Getty Images anytime we go out and meet with our customers is that you need to have more imagery of real people, you know, not staged, not too model looking, but real people, real bodies. So much so that we added a keyword to our content called real bodies. In order to be able to sort of meet this trend. And, you know, I think it's interesting you see, you know, Target ads where, you know, it's not a gorgeous looking model. It's a very, very real looking, you know, older woman. You know, these blogs popping up celebrating the beauty of women 60 and over. And, you know, again, just this trend of understanding that, you know, most of us out there have real bodies, and we are not super stick-thin supermodels. You know, I think a recent article that came out showing Adele is going to design for Burberry. You know, again, it's just, you know, celebrating how people really are. You know, and it's not just across women either. You know, men, and sort of, you know, celebrating that, you know, men are not always going to be your super six-pack ab guy, but you know, real men buy real products, and how do you associate with that? You know, I think one of a really popular campaign was Nike down here in the bottom right, which many of you may recall, that I think was pretty inspirational. And the fourth trend that we looked at was we call crowded, and it is what it says. But and I think most applicable to this panel discussion is just around crowdsourcing content. And you know, at Getty Images, we picked up on this trend and being able to do this about 3-4 years ago now, when we sparked a partnership with Flickr to allow us to curate from Flickr's pool of photographers and be able to source content that is real, is authentic, and has that look and feel that communicators are really looking for. And I think it's interesting how brands are moving towards sort of letting go of the reins of controlling their brand and giving it over to their consumers to be able to communicate and submit content on behalf of the brand. And I think it takes a lot of trust, and it's a pretty brave step for brands to be able to do that. And of course, you know, you've seen this across all of the sites that we just talked about, whether it's, you know, what Pinterest is doing for imagery, or you know, the like of similar sites like Food Gawker and others. But you know, this was a really interesting campaign that Target did, where they had people filming students receiving their college acceptance letters, and fed it out through a number of different social channels, including YouTube. And it was just really inspirational watching these kids get really excited about being accepted to college. You know, as I said, for us at Getty Images, we look to crowdsource across not only imagery but video through a partnership with Vimeo. And then we most recently announced a partnership with SoundCloud to be able to crowdsource music in a way that we haven't been able to in the past. So again, you know, we were able to go and find this type of real world content, secure it from the photographers with model releases, and then be able to offer this out to our customers in a way that, you know, art directing, we would never be able to get that shot on the lower left. You know, as much as you don't want to, you know, you want to try to create something like that, it's just a moment in time that you're not otherwise going to be able to recreate. You know, it's funny when you see some of these things and you're like, well, I don't know, would anybody really use this? And you know, is that something that's really saleable in a commercial space? And Adidas picked it up and ran campaigns with it. So, you know, it's really interesting and really neat for some of these, you know, really just amateur photographers to be able to not only, you know, get their content out there, but monetize it as well. And I think it's really interesting when we look at, and we say, okay, let's take a look at what was our most licensed image of beauty 5 years ago versus today. And you notice such a difference in the authenticity of imagery in just a short time. We're talking only 5 years. You know, men, you know, a very different look and feel in just 5 years. You know, babies, you know, again, it's, you know, much more highly produced shot on the left versus very natural looking on the right. You know, again, solar flares, imperfect. These are types of things that we probably wouldn't have allowed through our collection 5 years ago, because we'd say this is kind of, you know, amateur looking, but this is the style that's coming about. So again, you know, we have all of these trends and more on a site we call The Curve, which is our visual trends report, and it's at curve.gettyimages.com. You know, and right now we're looking at how financial industry visual trends are changing. But I'm going to move it on to Yoli from Microsoft.
Thank you. So my name's Yoli Chisholm, and I'm a digital marketing lead at Microsoft. And I've worked at Microsoft for off and on since about 2001. And faced some pretty tough crowds as a marketer, but I like to say none as tough as my two teenage kids. And lately, what I've been hearing from my kids when they've seen some of our Microsoft marketing is that oh-so-powerful word, cool. It's an exciting time to be at Microsoft, and it's an exciting time to be in the digital space. And I'm going to show you a couple of things that we've been using imagery in our marketing to sort of change the conversation, or at least change the tenor of the conversation around Microsoft. So when we think of imagery, we think of it as a key moment of truth in the customer journey. When you think about organizations and consumers as they go about their buying decision-making process, we use images to sort of inspire desire, to get them to put us on their short list, to get them to put us on their wish lists. We use images to inspire delight, to get them to hit that like button. And particularly in the digital space, what's key is using our images to show inspired design. You know, where consumers can't touch and feel a product, we really want the images to communicate the product truth. So innovation in design, ease of use, and just a beautifully made product. So we want to show inspired design in our images. And then lastly, we want to inspire dialogue. We want to get people talking. We want to get them sharing those images in their social circles, tweeting about it, blogging, posting. And I recently heard somebody sum it up in a way that I thought was really interesting but provocative, in that our images are essentially porn for products. So here's one way porn for products might look like. So a collective cool was heard around the world when we announced Surface in June. And we really, with that video, just wanted to use the imagery in that video to showcase the stage that we had built for Windows 8, and also showcase some beautiful materials that we had used in the making of the product. So the magnesium casing, and thoughtful and innovative design in the integrated kickstand and the keyboard cover. But mostly, we really wanted to just inspire desire and get people let me show you what happened. So essentially, we released some images. We released 5 images on surface.com. And what we saw is these images started to show up on their Pinterest boards. And what I thought was most interesting was sort of the names of these boards. You know, desire. I'm on it. Things to save up for. Things I must have. Things I crave. And so I really think we had kind of hit that notion of inspiring desire. One other team that we really think has used imagery well is, if when you think about Bing, and a few years ago we re-engineered our search product and did a complete redesign of the homepage, and working with our friends at Getty, we incorporated the notion of using beautiful photography on the homepage. And what we started to see is that people came back on a regular basis to check out the images that we were using, and it was a great way to reintroduce people to our search product and really drive engagement and drive discovery and drive ultimately interaction with the search product and get search top of mind. What has happened is we get feedback on a daily basis to people, how can we use these images? And I think you're going to start to see functionality that enables our users to start to do that more. We extended beyond photography to video, and last week we launched Panorama on the Bing homepage. It's just an interesting way to drive interaction, drive engagement, and was an interesting way to reintroduce the search product. And you know, we'd like to think that at Microsoft we have sort of upped our design game, both in our software as well as in our hardware. With Windows 8, it was a whole new set of design principles that are sort of visual, more intuitive, playful, and fully embrace the notion of touch. And with our hardware, you know, well, you've seen what we've done with Surface, but also before that, you know, look at our mouse arc. It's an interesting and inspired design. And that comes through in the use of our imagery. And so what started to happen is that we're really sort of inspiring a different dialogue around Microsoft. There was a recent article on Business Week that just talked about how even designers who are sort of fully entrenched in sort of competitors' platforms have, with the new design principles, have started to give Microsoft a different look. And in that article, it talks about a designer who decided they wanted to come and work for Microsoft because of sort of this emphasis on design and sort of working our design muscle a little bit more. But what's happened is that is actually starting to resonate with consumers as well. When you look at where our images are getting posted, look at the names of those boards, you'll see that they've definitely acknowledged that the work we're doing is sort of, you know, they've acknowledged that we've built some good design. The names of the boards, you know, design stuff, cool, beautiful stuff, interactive, industrial service design. So people are really starting to acknowledge, you know, with the images that we've put out there, that it's they really do reflect the product truths. So we've lastly, you know, inspired dialogue within the industry. Some of the headlines you guys have seen, you know, suddenly Microsoft is the hippest tech company around Microsoft's design drive. And the last example I'm going to give you is from our Internet Explorer team. And they really had a tough job. And they were an example where they really explicitly had to change the dialogue. They were working in a very competitive space. And here's how they did it. So like I said, you know, the IE team really had a difficult job. They are working in a very competitive space, and they wanted to support the IE9 launch with a campaign that acknowledged that they recognize there are people that hated the IE product. And so they built on Tumblr a destination called The Browser You Love to Hate. And they really was this sort of separate self-deprecating and really sort of transparent and honest acknowledgement that, you know, yes, we recognize that there have been some problems with our product, but we've launched this new product and we'd like you to come back and take a look. And so this experience was supported with a campaign around the theme of making a comeback. And they created a series of infographics that sort of outlined sort of different famous comebacks. And on the Tumblr site, you know, they had identified Tumblr because this was an audience that comprised of a lot of people that were using competitor browsers. And so when this browser, when this experience launched, we saw a lot of people reposting the images. We saw the experience also included a free Tumblr theme that a lot of people downloaded and used. And then we worked with the folks at Onion who create these funny, funny, humorous videos that get, but that become very viral. And we worked with them to create a video that showed this gentleman who was sort of in recovery from being a IE hater. And that video got over 600,000 views on YouTube and went viral. And then what I really liked about this campaign is that they sort of extended it into other social sites. So this is what we did, the experience we did on cheeseburger.com. And here, users had a chance to kind of generate their own version of a comeback. And we saw, you know, 400,000 people sharing their own versions of comeback in their social circles, whether on Twitter or on Facebook, et cetera. And then what you saw is these comebacks, both the ones that we had created and then also the ones that users had generated, showed up on Pinterest as well. And so it was a very viral campaign. It was that sort of campaign that sort of crossed all the social circles and sort of took on the business challenge that we had head on. And so that's it for me. Thank you.
Hi. Hi, my name is Marissa Brooks, and I kind of do the digital media for a company, a local company called glassybaby. And just in case anybody out there is not familiar with what glassybaby is, you might recognize Getty Images and Microsoft a little bit more than our name. We're a local company started by a three-time cancer survivor. So we have one product, and that product is glassybaby. And out of her experience with her cancer, she discovered glassblowing and discovered this little vessel that became this kind of vessel of hope. And where we're not quite as big as these guys, we are in the social media world. It's how we communicate with our community, and our community really is everything to us. So I'm just gonna give you a couple examples of how we use that and how images are everything to us. Our product is very experiential. So for people who can't be here to visit our local stores, showing them things through our social media is really the best way to kind of let them know who we are and what our product is. So this is an example of a color we have. We have hundreds of colors, but one product. Facebook is probably our biggest social media tool, and images for us are key. Last month was Ovarian Cancer Awareness Month, and we have a color where we donate 10% from our revenue directly to the Marsha Rivkin Cancer Center for Ovarian Cancer. And this for us is huge for engagement. We don't market, we don't advertise, so being able to show a lit product like this is huge for our community. Basically, we believe that being able to just see this light and this hope is gonna communicate to our community kind of who we are and what we are. This particular post for us, we just hit our 10,000 mark on for likes on Facebook. So we had 144 likes, but for us, the engagement with this was huge. We had 24 shares, so that was a big thing. We post this image, and what it does is it allows our community to do the talking for us. We don't have to say what we're doing or what we're selling. This kind of sells the product for us. Let's see. And as I mentioned with community, we like to incorporate user-generated images. So images that aren't just coming straight from us, we like images that are coming from our community. This is an example of one that was sent to us from a customer that she posted. It's a color called Happiness, and she lights this in memory of her dad. And so we took this from her and asked if we could use it. And we were able to kind of turn this around and post this to our community to show them how she's using this color. Without using CTAs, without telling people what to do, this was the community, again, the customer telling our community, this is what I light my glassybaby for, this is what this is for, this is how you can use it in your life. And again, a way that we just don't have to use that. Obviously, we're here to make money. We like to generate, this is another way that we like to generate our revenue. We like to post pictures that kind of explain to people the season or the time of year through color, through names. We posted this one not too long ago, and from this, we were able to generate about $5,000 worth of revenue in just that week alone with just these colors. So again, we're putting colors out there, we're suggesting things, but not only is this suggesting the current season, but again, it's just suggesting a lifestyle to people. That's what this product can be, and that's how we kind of try to talk about it on our social media. Pinterest is another area that we really like to use our product. It's definitely not as successful for us as Facebook is, but again, this for us, we're finding is having better ongoing lifelong traffic. People are pinning our colors and our product to their boards, and they're living there for however. I think it's hard for us to really say what Pinterest is doing for us quite just yet. It's new to a lot of people, but it's strictly image driven. So for us, I mean, it's something that we're learning a lot about, but definitely this is an example of a board we have that's kind of like our weddings board, which in my opinion is kind of one of the bigger topics that you'll find on Pinterest. For us, we're really, again, just learning more about this, but for us, it's kind of continuing to drive traffic for us, continuing to keep us relevant on people's minds. This is an example of some of our most recent, what we, again, we don't market, but We recently just hit our 1 million in giving mark, which is huge for us, being such a local company and having one product. For us, like Yoli was talking about, here we can use an image to kind of tell people what this product is. It's handmade. It's crafted by somebody, a local artist here in Seattle. And again, yes, we've given 1 million, but we don't want to applaud ourselves. We want to talk about how we can give 1 million more. So here, we're using simple imagery, hand-blown nature, one logo, that's it. We're not telling people what to do. We're letting this be their experience. And for us, this is a new kind of imagery that we're using. We generally just kind of have the product, but we're kind of trying to test out how people can, how people are going to respond to seeing, okay, this one product is made by somebody here in Seattle, and then kind of going from there. So basically, the gist for us at Glassy Baby is that images are key. Images are our biggest way to kind of communicate with the customer. We hope that, you know, Facebook will continue to be really strong for us, but images are kind of our best way to basically, you know, sell our product without having to say anything. People might laugh when they say we don't advertise, we don't market, but we really don't. We have a product, we let our customers and our community tell the story, and that's basically how we use it. And without images, you'd have to be there in person to do it, and obviously that can't happen. So images are really incredibly powerful for us, certainly. So that's about it for us. I'm gonna pass this over to Shauna.
All right, so how many people in here work for a small company or a startup? Wow, okay, that looks like 90%. I'm sure it's not quite that high, but that looked really high. All right, well, this is our team at Decide, and I tried to take a little bit of a different stance on images than the rest of the panel, and I tried to kind of focus on the scrappiness of being in a startup that doesn't have the resources available that maybe a big company does have. So just a little bit about my background. I've always worked for a big company. I worked for Comcast. I consulted with Google on social. I went to Nordstrom and just left Nordstrom 6 months ago. And now I'm at Decide.com. And at Decide, I know, similar to Glassy Baby, some people might not know what Decide does. We are a pretty geeky company. We help folks find the very best products to buy on the internet, and then it might seem a little bit impossible, but we tell you when to buy them, so we predict the future prices of products, so you know if now's a good time to buy or if you should wait a couple weeks to save a couple $100. And then we will guarantee our technology, so if we say it's a good time to buy and it's not, we'll pay you the difference. So very, very techy, right, sometimes, and also, you know, we have a small team. So what I tried to kind of highlight here in some of the slides I'm gonna go over pretty quick is how we not only incorporate images externally, but also internally as well. So first I'll share a little bit about what we do externally. the color looks kind of funny in here, we all look blue. But one of the things that we know, we sat down and we really put together our brand voice, not so we would have a disingenuous voice, but so we would know how we want to present ourselves as a team out to the rest of the, to our customers. So one of the insights that we had is that people absolutely love our team and they love data scientists. Data scientists, I've heard people say, are like rocket scientists. Like they just don't understand it totally, but they think it's really cool, they know it's the future. And I feel the same way, and I actually love our team at Decide. So we found out that images of our team and showing our team culture work really well. So here's one on snowgramming. We have special themes at the office. We do have a lot of fun at the office. This one was Mad Men Monday. So we took a photo, it's really, these have about, for us, given our team is so much fun and we just have so much fun at the office, these have a 50% higher engagement than some of our other posts that relate to gadgets or some of the products that we sell. So it was kind of an interesting insight coming to a startup that has such a great team and showing what works externally. Here's one of Mike Fridgen, our CEO, speaking. I think this was an NBC interview. So these type of images work really well, these behind the scenes, showing people what works, what our company's about, because a lot of people don't know about startups, especially startups here in Seattle. I wanted to include this one because I do get asked all the time, what do you do if you're a startup? You know, because big companies just have different resources available. So going back to that idea of spending a little bit of money and of paying to highlight your images, these are two very similar Facebook posts, and we put only $5 to the one on the right, and it got more than twice as many impressions as well as shares, and I mean, just like the metrics were off the chart, and it was only $5. So I hate to say it, but sometimes just being able to be seen is really important, and unfortunately, sometimes on Facebook, it's easier to do that if you can spend a little bit of money now with all the changes that they've made to Facebook recently. All right, so then it comes to sort of the geeky side of working at a tech startup. And we recently worked with the Wall Street Journal, and this one obviously probably isn't as good on Pinterest or some of these other channels, but it was perfect for the Wall Street Journal. They put this together, we worked with them on this image. This actually shows the life cycle in a day of a microwave and how many times it changed price. So it was really trying to get to the idea to consumers that prices are really volatile, and while you might not realize it, things are changing online, sometimes by the minute, as far as price. So that was what this story was about. And then here's another one on, it's kind of cut off, but the best time to buy for the holiday season. So just an example of more academic images that work better in longer form writing, and we were really impressed with what the Wall Street Journal did with these, and they had great engagement on the Wall Street Journal site. So a little bit about images as the internal headline for your internal team or your internal company. This is a heat map showing our homepage. So this is one of the ways that we incorporate user feedback into changes on design. And so this is how we look at it internally. And if you think about how we used to look at it, you know, it used to be talking about the images or talking about the homepage, what we might want to change about it. Now we're looking at an image to do that. So this one shows where people are clicking on one of our recent homepage designs. And then this one shows the scrolling, so how they're scrolling down the page and what they're looking at while they're scrolling. So we look really carefully at these. We spend a lot of time on them, and they do inform our design. And then a little bit about creating product marketing and creating a participatory marketing culture, which is also really important if you're at a small company or a startup. This one I actually included. It's from Nordstrom. And why I wanted to include it is it's from our Pinterest board. And by the way, at Nordstrom, right before I left 6 months ago, Pinterest was driving an insane amount of traffic, an insane amount of sales. It was the number one sales channel for social. So for some retail companies, it really is working well. And what was interesting to us is this image was the highest for a really long time. It was the most repinned and had the most engagement. The most people were liking it. And you wouldn't think so, right? It's just, I mean, I wouldn't have thought that it would be this. So this type of thing really informed at Nordstrom, and then it also, we're carrying it over to Decide, informing what we're sharing with the community, looking at what they like and then sharing the types of things that they like. So this is another example from Nordstrom. We went and asked folks what their favorite pair of shoes was. We asked them to go into their closet, take a picture of their favorite pair of shoes, and this was one of the highest engaged posts for us on Facebook for quite a long time. It broke all of our previous records. And we had shoes like this, and then all the way to shoes like this, and like this. So, I mean, it was people like, you know, there weren't a lot of guys looking at our Facebook page, but to see that some guys, I mean, I think this is a guy, and this one's really a guy. So to see that, like, we really brought out all this engagement, hundreds of people went into their closet and took a photo of their favorite pair of shoes. So figuring out what the insights are for your brand and then really sticking to those and involving the community. So I want to share one example of what we did at, and I can't share the whole thing because this is a private group, but one of the things that we've done at Decide.com is, and I've wanted to do this at all the companies I was at before. I wanted to do this when I was at Comcast. I wanted to do it when I was at Nordstrom. But it's almost a scary thing to do as a brand. So what we did is we created this private environment for our biggest fans. And what we promised them is we would share with them information before it went out to the media. We would involve them in our product design. We would ask for their feedback, and we would incorporate their feedback when they told us what they wanted. So we were able to do that. We have a private group on Facebook. We figured out Facebook was the best way to do it because people are spending time there. That's where our target customer is spending time on Facebook. So we share info with them, a lot of images with them of homepage designs, of different designs, and ask what they think and ask for their feedback. make changes, and then put it live on our site. So we know that it's going to work before we actually, or we believe it's going to work before we actually put it on our site. And this one's not a pretty or aspirational photo, but this is one that we got back from one of our customers on our site. So this was the post I shared asking for some feedback. He responded with this over, I don't know how long this took him, but we couldn't believe it, like an overview of how we should lay it out, how we should design it. And it was really fun to see that not only we were sharing photos with our community, but they were also sharing photos back with us and kind of incorporating their information and putting it together in an image versus, you know, what this probably would have been is like three pages of text if you would have sent it to us. So creating an influencer group and then using images in that group can be really powerful too. So I'm gonna pass it over to Karen so we can go to the Q&A.
We're running a little late, so I wanted to make sure that everyone in the audience that has a question has a chance to ask. So if you have a question, please come up to the microphone in the middle here.
Hey, so a lot of you are using images to drive traffic, or I assume to drive web traffic, to create engagement, to ultimately drive sales. Are you guys giving much thought to the SEO implications of using images? And some of you who have a really heavy Facebook strategy, are you also ensuring that those images are living in more searchable environments?
Does anyone want to take that?
I mean, I know we definitely, the SEO thing is a little bit newer to us at Glassy Baby, but I know it's a great question. I know that for us, all of our images, we definitely keep that in mind. It's all of our traffic from Facebook. We are trying to drive back to glassybaby.com. So SEO is definitely something for us that we're trying to build, that we're also building into our Facebook images. Any images we put on there, we're kind of including all the SEO that we can to make it one of the top ones that you'll see when you search us. So I don't know if you guys incorporate that in yours.
Yeah, I mean, without a doubt. Yeah. I mean, for us, I mean, it's enormous for us to be able to drive traffic back from wherever our content is being placed. So, especially when you look at Bing image search results, Google image search results, and, you know, how can we monetize that sort of free aggregation of content by driving traffic back to all of our different properties. It's definitely a strategy that I think most people are going to want to try to adopt.
Any other questions? I'm going to throw one out there. Can you use images to target a specific kind of customer or a subsegment of your customers?
That's something that we're definitely looking at. You know, on the team that I work on, we're focused on the enterprise side of the business. And so we have audience segments like developers, IT pros, small business users, and with the phenomenon around Pinterest, we've been trying to think about how can we leverage what we see happening on Pinterest and incorporate that in how we think about the use of images on our sites. And the small business segment is one that has really popped up, you know, where we see on Pinterest people pinning quotes from, you know, famous business makers, or pinning aspirational or inspirational images. And we think that is something that we can tie to the small business segment. These are folks who are, you know, when you talk about really, you know, smaller sized companies through to, you know, the one person entrepreneur who's a startup, through to maybe the 5 to 20 size company, you know, they all need some inspiration. And particularly with female entrepreneurs, we've seen that's something that seems to be resonating. And I think you're gonna start to see the enterprise customers trying to think about how they can make their images resonate with those groups.
We have another question.
Hi. Sorry, mic's a little tall. I'm a little short. So this question is actually mostly for Ken, but I'd love to hear from the whole panel. My name is Brooke. I'm with a company called Admosis Media, and we spend the majority of our time thinking about advertising on Facebook. I was really interested in what you had to say about kind of the importance of real images, real bodies. We've been doing a lot of testing with imagery like that to try to understand in a hyper-targeted capacity what's going to move people to click through and engage. And the challenge is, we had a hypothesis that we would try to be more real with some of these images, and they do not generally perform as well as, pardon me, the hot chick. you know? And so there's a bit of a, like, there's a bit of battle of odds because we really want to embrace this and we do think it's, we'll build a more human connection, but if it doesn't drive the click, then we're not doing our job.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a good point. I think it just really depends on the type of company that you are. I mean, you know, still aspirational marketing for luxury brands, that's probably, you know, something that, you know, Real Bodies probably doesn't always play. And you sort of need to drive reaction through, you know, a different style of photography. But, you know, I think it's just, it depends on the segment of business that you're in and whether that is effective or not. You know, I look at what Expedia has been doing lately in their marketing in changing the way that you look at travel imagery. And again, it's got that much more real and authentic look. It isn't that sandals commercial of the really hot chick in the bikini that, frankly, I've never seen on vacation. You know, it's usually me sunburnt, you know, looking really pale. But, you know, I think it just depends on the segment of business that you're in, whether or not that's effective or not.
Yeah. So are you seeing any trends around performance associated with that?
Yeah. I mean, you know, in terms of driving behavior, I mean, you know, for us in particular, I just know, again, what we look at in terms of what people are searching for and what people are responding to on our site. You know, the way that we aggregate our search results are all aggregated based on our customer behavior and who's clicking on what. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting when you go across search terms to see what's aggregated towards the top of search results. And it does tend to be more in the, again, you know, the travel space, even more so in the financial services space now, where you see that trend of realism playing out more so than, again, to your point, in, you know, some of the other, you know, aspirational brands or high fashion brands.
Thanks.
I think we have time for one more question.
Well, now I don't know what to do because I had two. We'll see how fast we can get through it. I'm Morgan, I'm a student at UW, and my first question is really about the title you guys used, Images Are the New Headline. For me, I think visuals has always been really powerful for individuals. Advertising has been using images as long as possible. Why did you use Images as the New Headline? What is so different about now than the last 100 years of advertising?
I think what's different is that images are, in some cases, replacing text completely, that we are seeing a single image actually communicating, whereas before it used to be an image with text or an image with a headline.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the research is overwhelming that anybody in the social media space, you know, consumers are much more willing to interact, repost, or just generally interact with imagery as opposed to text posts. So, you know, I think it's important really for all companies to think about how can they use imagery in social media to, you know, drive that natural interaction with their customer base.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things that we've seen at Microsoft is, whereas before we might have had sort of a, you know, on our site, we might have had an article or a post or a white paper on a particular topic. But when you test that against a video on that topic or, you know, an image that communicates it, you know, inevitably the video outperforms the article. And so I think that's just extending into, you know, just the notion that people respond to visuals, particularly in the fact that, you know, now when we see the different form factors that people are using, you know, they're loving looking at visuals on their tablets, on their phones, et cetera. So I think you're right. People have always engaged in images, but I think it's just being I think because of the form factors and because of social and what's being shared, we're just seeing people using images and interacting with images more so.
So can I follow up on that? Do we have time for that?
Quickly.
Question 1.5. So now, you know, images are the new headline. What do you guys see as the next evolution of this?
Well, you know, I think there's, do you want to go? No, I was just going to say, you know, much like the folks at glassybaby, you know, we're still trying to understand what we should do in the context of things like Pinterest. We've seen that it works really well for folks in the e-commerce or retail sector, but on the B2B side of the business, there's still a lot of learning, just even with the notion of images being the new headline. So the next evolution of it, you know, who knows? I think there's a lot, as hardware companies embrace touch, I think it's gonna be interesting to see how we can create more interactive experiences within an image. I think you've started to see that with what Bing has done with hotspots. I think we're gonna see a lot more of that. You know, I'm interested to see where it's gonna go.
First, I love your questions. Yeah. Just go straight to it. I wanted to say something really quick, and I know we've been talking about video as the next frontier for a long time, but my favorite app right now is called Pitch. P-T-C-H, and it's by the folks at DreamWorks. And you can actually take a video and you can take a photo and put it into this little montage and put music behind it, and it's just really fun. There are other apps that do that too, but this one does it in a little bit more of a creative way. So I think we're starting to see it finally start to catch up, and brands can tell their story more and in a more scrappy way. Even startups can use these technologies without spending, you know, thousands of dollars. So I mean, that's just one that we've seen coming for a little while, but I just have to say I love that app, so.
Thank you. Well, I'd like to thank our panelists, Ken, Yoli, Marissa, and Shauna. Thank you very much. And thank you for coming out to our panel.